our scripture reading this morning, which is Hebrews 10, 24 through 25, and Psalm 133, verse 1. And let us consider how to stir up one another to love and good works, not neglecting to meet together, as in the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day drawing near. Behold, how good and pleasant is it when brothers dwell in unity together. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Well, friends, it is so good to be here. We are not necessarily in the house of the Lord, but the church is the body of Christ. The church is where the Holy Spirit dwells. Amen. And he dwells within us. And so wherever we are gathered, we are the church. And we are the church right now gathered on this gorgeous day in Hermitage, Pennsylvania, giving thanks to our Creator. So we've had sort of this three-month lag, and I hope and pray that you've been blessed and encouraged through the media that the staff has put out to get the message out and not only keep the messages going to encourage you all, but our prayer is also that those messages went out to those beyond everyone gathered here and into the community. And hopefully there have been people that have been encouraged and even come to know Christ through those videos. Maybe we'll never know, but the Bible calls us to plant seeds, and that's what we've been doing. Well, we are back together, and I thought I would share with you and remind us all the importance of gathering together. And so I have 4 points that I'd like to share with you, the importance of going to church. And the first point is simply this: we should go to church because that's God's will for us. We gather because it is God's will that we should gather. He commands us to gather. We've just heard Seth read from Hebrews, and the Bible says that we ought to not neglect gathering together, that when we gather together, that we should spur each other on to good deeds. And there's something for us to think about there, 2 things. The first is, when we gather together, we can spur each other on. We make each other better just by being around each other. We encourage one another. We sharpen one another. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 27, verse 17, the Bible says that iron sharpens iron, so shall one man sharpen another. Well, you can't sharpen iron and you can't sharpen another by living a solo life. You have to be engaging with one another. And that's what things like church and Sunday school are all about. We're getting together, we're fellowshipping, but we're also encouraging and challenging one another to become better people, better Christians, so that when we leave here and go into the world, we're more Christ-like. But the author of Hebrews also mentions the word neglect, neglecting. So think with me for a moment what it means to neglect, especially neglecting church. You don't want to neglect something that's so important to you. You don't want to neglect fellowship. It's easy to do, especially when it's beautiful outside. We have hobbies, we have scheduling conflicts, or some of us have dates with our pillows. The important thing is we give priority to church and we do not neglect it. Church attendance should be the norm in our lives. It should be a regular rhythm, which leads us to our next point. We should attend church because of the fellowship that we have with one another. We read in the book of Acts that as soon as the early church was formed, that they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching, fellowship, the breaking of bread, and to prayer. Think of those things for a moment. The teaching of the apostles. They went to church and they devoted themselves to those teachings. Where else are you going to get those teachings? Where else in your life are you going to get the teachings of the Word of God? I know it's easy to find them on YouTube. I just referred to that. But there's nothing like the real thing. There's nothing like being here. Also, there's fellowship. When we're together, it certainly feels good, doesn't it? Doesn't it feel good to look around the parking lot and see one another gathered? It's encouraging. If for nothing else, to meet today and to encourage one another just simply by being here in the presence of other believers. It's extremely encouraging. The next thing that the apostles did is they broke bread together. You know, we should strive for time, not just on Sunday mornings, to connect with one another. But the Bible speaks of an intimate fellowship, and that means meeting together outside of Sunday morning, outside of just this hour, where we become friends and share life together. We share our joys, our hopes, our dreams, our pains, and in that way, we strengthen one another and we need one another. And then finally, the Bible says in Acts that they prayed for one another. When is the last time you had somebody come up to you and say, "I hear you, can I pray with you?" That's a powerful thing. And the world does not offer that. Only a believer in Christ can offer that, where they could hear you, spend time with you, and lift that burden up to God. But there's another reason to meet together, and it's this. You and I, right now, are being a witness in the world. There are cars driving by right now as we are gathered, and they're noticing that this parking lot is full, that we are here gathered. Think back to the commandments. God calls us to cease working and to stop the rhythm of our lives to meet together. Think with me for a moment what that must have been like for the Israelites. We live in a culture today where church is a normal part of our lives, where Sunday morning is reserved for church. But when this commandment was given, it was given in a time and in a world where nobody stopped, nobody ceased, nobody went and devoted themselves to worship one day of the week and stopped working. My point is, could you imagine the unbelieving world watching the Israelites stop one day of the week and watch them all gather together to worship God? Do you know how confusing that must have been to the unbelieving world? Do you know how shocking that was? Looking at their neighbors going, "Hey, where are you going? How come you're not working today?" It stood out to them. It was a witness to them. Just like today, what we're doing is a witness to the unbelieving world. I'm willing to bet that through this whole 3-month span, you have had conversations with some of your friends and you've said, "I really miss church. I really miss going to church. I really miss my church family." And I'm guessing that some of your friends or family just couldn't understand and associate with you why this was so important. And now you're here gathered. It's a witness to the unbelieving world that we stop what we're doing and we gather together in the name of Christ, and we plug in with one another, and we plug in with God, and we stop the normal rhythm of our lives to come and worship God. The last point is that we are here to encourage one another. You know, there's this phrase used in the New Testament over and over and over again. One another. Encourage one another. Love one another. Bear one another's burdens. And that phrase, one another, is used in the New Testament just about 100 times. Why is it used so much? The reason why is because we are called to live the Christian faith in community. We're not rebels. We don't have solo acts. We're called to live in community. Finally, I'd like to share with you a story. Many of you have heard of Ravi Zacharias. Ravi Zacharias recently passed away. He was one of the most incredible Christian thinkers of the last 50 years, and he has made an incredible influence on not only the believing world, but the unbelieving world. And he wrote a book called Jesus Among Other Gods, and in it he tells a story. And I want to read it for you all, because one of the things that I know that I have experienced over these last 3 months, and I'm guessing that you have also, is you have experienced a sense of sadness over the things that you have missed. You have experienced a sense of sorrow over the things that you have not been able to do. And for me, one of the highest was, of course, being in church, worshiping God with all of you. And he tells a story that highlights that. And I'm going to read it for you. In his play, Our Town, Thornton Wilder tells the story of a life as it is lived out in the mundane, in amid the hassless days of living. The details are specific, but the lesson is like a mirror held out for all of us. We see the routine. The milk arrives. The bills come in. Breakfast is eaten. People go to their jobs. In the story, the turning point comes when Emily Gibbs, in her youthful prime, dies giving birth to her baby, and the routine is suddenly broken. Now, from the realm of the dead, Emily was given a chance to return to Earth for a day of her choice, one day that she could choose. And now, from her otherworldly existence, she viewed it with nostalgic eyes. She viewed it and watched the activities that went on, the busyness of her 12th birthday. And as she well remembered, the household was preoccupied with presents and food and chatter, and the party buzzed with activity. But now, in this irreversible state, Emily noticed the complete loss of any personal attention. But her heart craved for it. The focus instead was on the things that needed to be done, rather than the people for whom it was done. She was aghast at such blindness to all of their real needs. From the unseen, she pleaded, "Just for a moment, we were happy. Let's look at one another." But her cry was unheard. "Let's be happy, please." But they could not hear her. The party had to go on. Another birthday would come. The moments would dissipate. And then she bid her farewell, and she cried to Earth, "You're too wonderful for anyone to realize you." And then she turns to the stage, who serves as the narrator, and asks this question: why do human beings never realize the life that they have while they're living it? Why do human beings never realize the life while they are living it? You see, she was able to see, as she looked back on her life, that precious moment that everyone overlooked, because she thought there was going to be another birthday next year, and she thought there was going to be more presents next year. But what happened was a tragedy in her life, and she came to realize only on the other side just how precious life is. And I'm here to tell you that in these last 3 months, many of us can understand and appreciate just how precious Faith Presbyterian Church is, just how precious we all are, just how precious this staff is, and just how precious our faith in Jesus Christ is. So I want us to think about, before I pray, don't live your life going forward thinking that you have forever. Enjoy these moments. Everybody look around right now. Look at the people sitting around you. This is a precious moment that in maybe 5, 10, or 15, or 20 years, you're going to look back on one day. And you're going to say, "I remember the times we had at Faith Presbyterian Church. I remember when we sat outside and listened to that sermon, and I don't remember all the details, but I remember this." Man. this is the only place that I'd want to be right now. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.